So, like most people, when I got into my teenage years, I just became like a pretty hardcore atheist. I really fell into that form of like online atheism. You guys all know that type of atheism, where they're like, oh, like believing in God is so stupid. Believing in God's like believing in Santa Claus. So I was like one of those type of guys for a long time. So yeah, those were bad days. But when I was in my early teenage years, you know, I just lived a pretty bad life. I was just addicted to lust, addicted to, you know, gaming, spent all my time on Call of Duty, on, you know, live chat, and you know what that's like. So I was one of those type of guys, yeah. But going into high school, I just, you know, didn't believe there was any meaning to life. I thought everything was just, you know, just random. It was sort of like, you know, we're just here and we just, you know, disappear. We come to nothingness. So I really just thought I should just maximize my pleasure at every moment. So I started living like that. And I got into the wrong crowd. I started partying a lot, started smoking weed. And then I just had this mindset of just like maximize pleasure. Because like, what other purpose is there if we're just all going to die? And so coming into college, I really, really carried that out. I became a hardcore stoner. I was getting high every single night. In the first couple weeks at Tech, I bought like 20 grams of weed in the first week, and the guy I bought it from was locked up in jail like a few months later. And I was just living, you know, just like that, like sneaking to frat parties. Like this one time, we weren't on the list for this AGR frat party, so we climbed underneath the fence, and then we snuck through the back, and we broke through their back basement window, and we got into the party that way. So I was just like living with like no morality. My only morality was just maximizing my pleasure at every moment. And I lived like this all of freshman year and part of sophomore year, but I realized that I was still unfulfilled. Also, I got 3 CRs in the first 3 months, by the way. Yeah, so I was like, you know, just really bad life, and my parents weren't very happy. I was very secretive about all these things, but they're like, how did you get 3 conduct referrals in 3 months? And it's just because I was just, you know, living a chaotic lifestyle. And so I was, you know, just living a terrible lifestyle. I was addicted to video games. I spent like 75 days on this game called Fortnite. I don't know if you guys heard of it, but I had 75 days played in less than 2 years, and that's a lot of time. You know, I was addicted to weed, I was addicted to lust, I was addicted to all these, you know, evil things. And every night during the summer of 2019, I would just, you know, sneak off, hit my dad pen, go on adventures with some guys from my neighborhood and stuff like that, and basically pull an all-nighter, do some crazy stuff, and then go home and sleep all day. And my parents were like, why is this kid always like, you know, sleeping all day? Why is he gaming all day? Because I was just living a terrible life, but I still felt unfulfilled. It was this weird paradox. I was maximizing my pleasure at every moment, but everything just felt wrong. My life was disordered. And I was like, every single night when I was high and journaling, I wrote about how much I hated my life. I wrote about how much I, you know, regretted my actions. I realized that I was not free. I was a slave to all of my desires. And I couldn't quit any of these things. I tried quitting, you know, video games. I tried quitting smoking weed. I tried quitting lust, all these things. But I just kept falling back into these things. It felt like my body was like taken over. And I like was compelled to do these things. And so I realized, okay, these things are finally, like these things are bad. I came to acknowledge that during the summer of 2019. But I couldn't do anything about it. And then I saw this one Jordan Peterson video where he, yeah. So I saw this one Jordan Peterson video where he was talking about this drug called ayahuasca, right? So ayahuasca is like a psychoactive drug that like shamans use in like Africa. And he was talking about like this John Hopkins research study that basically said that 80% of people who were addicted to cigarettes after taking ayahuasca and meeting this figure called Mother Ayahuasca, they basically quit smoking for life. And I was like, what the heck? That's so crazy. But there's like actual scientific evidence about this. And I was like, I have to get my hands on this ayahuasca stuff. Sadly, I didn't get my hands, or luckily, I didn't get my hands. yes, let's get it. Yes. Luckily, I didn't get my hands on this, but instead, I got my hands on LSD acid. And so I took acid. Well, it was mostly for fun in the first time, but I had the secondary intention of, you know, possibly quitting weed. Because I knew that this was like a drug that increased your neuroplasticity. So I thought that maybe this would, you know, allow me to quit smoking weed. So I came in still pretty hardcore atheist at this time. And I took some acid with a good friend of mine. And I don't know, it was just the craziest experience. It just like rocked my world. The best way to describe it was like, him and I were like yin and yang. We were opposites in this eternal dance. Sounds mad, I know, but it made me realize that, okay, well, it seems like mind is like completely unrestricted. It's dynamic. It's not just a bunch of atoms bumping into each other. It's not just like a rock, right? It's something just qualitatively different. And it's the hardest thing to describe, but during this experience, during this trip, like we started thinking about, you know, philosophical questions like, what is the meaning of life? What is consciousness? And all of these questions, you know, these questions I've always, you know, I guess, dealt with, but the experience I had just totally changed my answers to these questions. And so me and him, we wrote this short, like, dramatic play that basically summarized all of our philosophical investigations. And then afterwards, I ended up, you know, quitting smoking completely, quitting gaming completely, and I just started pursuing the truth. I realized whatever I was doing when I was on that acid trip, that's like, you know, what I should be doing. Not acid, of course, but pursuing truth. Let me clarify that. Do not do acid. But I realized my past life was just filled with these lower goods, these fleshly goods, these carnal goods. And they were blocking me from things that really mattered, like pondering why we exist at all. What is the purpose of existence? And so I got really into philosophy. I stopped hanging out with all my friends because all of my friends were just friends of utility. All we did together was get high, smoke, and, you know, do bad things, basically, just party and whatnot. I didn't really care about these people at all. I just cared about how they made me feel. So I basically became a hermit. The only person I talked to was my roommate and my mom, basically, during this like, 9-month period. But, oh yeah, so this was the summer or September of 2019 when this all started. And so I got really into philosophy. I started questioning, you know, why is there something rather than nothing? And I came to the conclusion that if there was just, you know, ever strictly pure nothingness, you know, nothing does nothing. So there would always be nothingness. So I came to the realization that there had to always be something. And this I called God. But at this point in time, I still didn't have a good understanding of God. I thought God was like the universe. I thought we were all going to become God. I was what you'd call a pantheist at that time. But I was getting closer to a lot of these, you know, answers. And so I was taking acid pretty regularly during this time, and I was treating it more as a spiritual journey. The first time I took it, it was more just about entertainment, about, you know, how it made me felt. But the other times, it was more like I'm doing an investigation into reality. And so I started asking these philosophical questions and started trying to resolve them while on acid. And so one acid trip after that, I stared at fractals, these things, for 8 hours. So if you guys don't know what a fractal is basically like a recursive mathematical function that is like visualized, right? And I was staring at this for like 8 hours, and it was like the coolest thing ever. I was like, God is like dancing before my eyes. I was looking at it, right? And I was obviously hallucinating and tripping, but I saw all these objects pop up from these fractals. I saw like octopuses and, you know, scenes from like a fairy tale. It was like I was walking into a forest and I just kept seeing things pop up. And I thought to myself, okay, wait, this is like one fractal. And I looked at this for like 8 hours. Imagine if I had like 1,000 of these or maybe an infinite amount of these fractals, but I stared at these for like an infinite amount of time. I just came to this amazing conclusion that everything would be in there. And I was like, everything is contained in the infinite, right? And so this really guided my philosophy at this time. And I was developing this more and more. And 3 months had passed since I first took acid. And now it's around December time. And things start getting weird. You know, I'm just sleeping one night. It's just a regular dream. And then, boom, I wake up and I see myself in third person. And I hear this voice, loud booming voice, say, Brian. And I was like, what was that? And then it said, you are a follower of Satan. And I freaked out. And I was like, what the heck? I thought this was real life because everything in my room was laid out properly. My bed was where it was properly. You know, my poster, my Joker poster was where it was properly. I had to clarify, Joker poster. And, you know, all my books were where they were. And I was like, how am I seeing myself in third person? And what is this voice, right, like saying my name? And so I started questioning it because I thought it was God. I was like, oh, if you're God, like, why should I listen to you? Because there's evil in the world, right? So I said stuff like that, and he started laughing at me. He's like, ha ha ha. And so I was scared out of my mind, and I woke up into another dream. into another dream, right? These are nested dreams, and I'm seeing myself, and I'm seeing myself in third person. And this time there's this black thing, 7 foot long, 6 feet, 7 feet long, pinning me down. Now I think it's a demon. Back then I just knew it was evil. It was bad. It was pinning me down. I couldn't move at all. And I was just laying there, and I felt this thing on me. I was like, oh, what do I do? So I started wiggling my fingers, and eventually I freed myself from that, and I woke up in another dream. But this time in first person. I'm in first person in my room, and everything's set up properly. And I peed my pants in the dream. Don't worry. And I peed my pants, and so I was like, I gotta go, like, clean up. So I walked to the bathroom, and I turn on the light, and I'm in the mirror. I'm like, yeah, I peed my pants. And I look at myself, I'm like, what do? I gotta clean up. And everything just melts to black, and now I'm in real life. I'm like, what the heck just happened? I slapped myself, I'm like, is this real life? It was real life. And so I ran and told my roommate all about it, and we're like, weird. yeah. And so, afterwards, I was like, that's really weird, but it could probably be explained, like, you know, psychologically or something. I don't know. I didn't think about it too much. And by the way, I was sober during this time. I didn't take acid for like a month during this time. I know, shocker. But during that same month, actually, the night of Christmas, I did something pretty bad, pretty regrettable. And then the night after that, I had a dream that had aspects of that. And it was just like the previous dream. You know, I'm having a regular dream, and then I wake up, and I'm in my room, and everything just seems regular, but I'm in a dream, right? My sister's in the bathroom, and she's taking a shower, and I'm going to sleep. So I walk to bed, I head over to sleep, and as I fall asleep, everything is spiraling, and I enter into the state of pure bliss, and I hear this voice again say, Brian, same voice from the previous dream. I'm like, whoa, what is going on? And then it tried to show me some, like, cool kaleidoscope, kaleidoscope-looking, like, geometry. And it's trying to explain to me, like, what this meant. And I was like, I have no clue what this means. And it started laughing at me. And then it was like, it's going to take me to something else. So it took me to what looked like an E8 lattice. And this is, like, for all you math nerds, E8 lattice. I don't even know what an E8 lattice is. All right, it doesn't matter. Anyways, E8 lattice, it's something about, like, math and stuff like that. Yeah, you know, some of you big brains out here probably know what I'm talking about. Anyways, it presented me this E8 lattice-looking thing on the ceiling, and it was trying to explain to me, like, the meaning of, like, the world or something like that. And I, you know, I didn't really know what was going on, but I started questioning it again. And then it started laughing, and I woke up in another dream. In another dream, right? I'm in my room again. My sister's in the bathroom, and I'm like, this is weird. I should go tell my sister. So I went to tell my sister, and she hopped out of the bathroom, and we were heading to her room. And as I walked into her room, I saw this rotting girl, this girl with maggots crawling out of her eyes, looked like a Coraline doll, basically. And it had to do with the bad thing I did, basically on her bed frame. And I was shocked. I was like, what the heck is this? But my sister's like, what do you mean? What do you mean, what is this? And I was like, do you not see that demon right there? And so I knocked it down, I started punching it. But as I punched it, it turned into a teddy bear. And then my sister just looked at me like, are you schizophrenic? Like, what's going on? And so she kicked me out of her room, and I went back to bed. And this is all in the dream. Okay, so I'm going back to bed, and I fall asleep, and everything is spiraling again. We're entering into the state of just complete bliss, complete white noise. And I'm hearing this voice, loud booming voice again. And this time, it's like projecting like the universe onto my ceiling, and it's trying to explain to me something. And once again, I question this thing. I'm like, you know, if you're God, why do animals die? Animals suffer a lot, and, you know, like, why? They didn't do anything wrong. And it started laughing at me. It said I wouldn't understand. And then I woke up from that dream. In another dream, I'm in a room. It's just my room with three lights on. And then I wake up in reality. And now I'm in reality, and I hear my sister, and she's in the bathroom, in the shower. I'm like, what the heck? Like, what is going on here? So I thought, maybe I should go tell her about this. But I realized that when I told her about this dream in the dream, she got freaked out, and she didn't want to hear it, and she kicked me out of her room. So I thought that was a sign from God not to tell her. But I didn't care what God, you know, I didn't care what God wanted me to do. So I went to tell her anyways. But I fell asleep on my phone charger. And so when I got up, the phone charger wrapped 5 times around my arm, and it was tugging me back. And I was like, wow, this is like a definite sign from God not to tell her. But I told her anyways. So I went to tell my sister, and as we got to the part about, you know, the demon girl and stuff, she got sort of like freaked out, and she didn't really want to listen to it, and it didn't really go anywhere. I was like, okay, yeah, I should have listened to God. Who would have known? And still at this time, I'm like thinking, okay, maybe there's a way to explain this stuff, like, you know, psychologically. It's possible, right? It's possible. Maybe it's all just like in my mind, just like archetypes and stuff like that, right? And so I'm still doing philosophy, and by now I've written maybe hundreds of pages on my whole pantheistic philosophy. And it sort of makes sense, but sort of doesn't. It's answering some questions. It says, like, you know, morality actually exists, and morality is what helps us, you know, become God. But I couldn't make sense of how we become God. How does this, you know, turtle and this rock and I merge into God? That makes no sense. I just couldn't solve that problem. It's because it doesn't make sense. But I was still working on this philosophy stuff for a while. And then no progress really is done for like 2 months, 3 months. And so this is probably like mid-February 2020. And I haven't taken drugs since maybe November. And I'm thinking I should hop back onto, you know, these psychedelic drugs because they really helped me think. And so I was watching this one guy. His name is Terrence McKenna. And he's a very big psychonaut, as they call it. He really likes exploring consciousness and taking drugs. In other words, he likes taking drugs. And so he was talking about how, you know, when people take these shrooms, they meet, you know, all these weird supernatural entities. And I remember that Jordan Peterson was talking about ayahuasca, people meeting Mother Ayahuasca. And there's just so many reports of, you know, people talking to these like weird supernatural entities, which I think are just demons. But yeah, and I was like, I don't really believe this, but I want to try it because, you know, so many people are saying this works. And so I got 5 grams of dried psychedelic mushrooms. I blindfolded myself, and then I recited this prayer that he told me to. He said, recite this prayer. Hello, my name is Brian Dwong. I'm a friend of Terrence McKenna. I want to hear the voice of the mushroom. May God have mercy on my soul. I recited this prayer for 15 minutes while taking 5 grams of dried mushrooms. And 5 grams of dried mushrooms is a lot. Like, if you're taking it for the first time, 1.5 is like a good amount. It's not good, but it's an amount. It's an amount. And so 5 grams, that's a lot, right? And so I'm taking this, I'm reciting this prayer 50 minutes. 50 minutes in, it feels like my stomach's gonna kill me. It feels like I'm in a washing machine. And it feels like the mushroom is trying to integrate with me. That's the best way I could put it. And it just felt terrible. I thought I was gonna vomit, but then I heard this loud booming voice say, Brian, the same loud booming voice I heard from the couple past dreams. And I was like, what? I took off my blindfold, I looked around. None of my roommates were in the apartment. I was like, who said that? And I put my blindfold back on. I kept reciting this prayer, and from the distance, I heard a wave of classical music come in. It was the best music I've ever heard. It was better than Beethoven, better than Bach. It was just completely euphoric. It was like the perfect autobiography of my entire life presented to me. All of my thoughts, my words, all of my actions, emotions were just being presented to me in music form. And I was praying, I was like, wow, this is so good. I gotta go like journal and write this down. So I get my leather notebook and I get my pencil and I'm gonna like write this down. But the feeling of the leather and the feeling of the pencil gets translated to music. And so I'm over here rubbing my leather notebook and rubbing my pencil and like, ah, yes, beautiful music. like an absolute schizophrenic, but yeah. So I kept doing this and I was like, wow, this is so good. This is too euphoric. I gotta figure out where this music's coming from. So I keep reciting this prayer. My name is Ryan Dwong. I'm a friend of Terrence McKenna. I wanna hear the voice of the mushroom. May God have mercy on my soul. Right, I'm reciting this over and over and over again. And then boom, I see a vision. I'm in like this grand cathedral and there's a bunch of angels, a choir of angels in a circle, and they're the ones singing this song. I'm like, wow, this is beautiful. This is great. Like, why are they in a circle? Let me try to focus in on what's in the center of the circle. And I saw for a brief moment a silhouette of Christ. And I just freaked out. I was like, what the heck? Because I didn't want it to be true. Because I didn't want Christianity to be true. Because I just wanted to live how I wanted to live. So I was freaking out. And I like took my blindfold off. And the music was going away. And it felt like the radio signal was sort of getting loosened. And so I was trying to like, you know, I was freaked out. But I also wanted to hear the music. So I was like, I got to recite this prayer again. May God have mercy on my soul. I want to hear the voice of the mushroom. May God have mercy on my soul. Right? I'm reciting this mushroom prayer again. And then I see this vision of the angels again in the cathedral. And I see this silhouette of Christ. I'm like, yeah, that's definitely Christ. And it's so powerful and it's so strong. But I want to deny it. And I'm freaking out. And I want to tell my friends about this because I had a friend who also took this with me and a friend who babysat both of us. But they went outside to like look at stuff. Right? And so, yeah. And so I eventually, you know, went and told them about it, and they're like, what do you mean you hear music? Like, what do you mean you saw Christ, right? And it was just so hard to describe. And, you know, that trip ended, and I was like, what happened? Like, how, like what just happened? I do not know what happened. I still want to just say that it was just like, oh, it was just like psychology. It was just like maybe like, you know, an archetype. You know, Christ is like the symbol of a perfect man. Maybe that's what it was, right? So I was still very reluctant to, you know, accept this stuff. So I decided, okay, yeah, maybe there's some other explanation. Who cares? I didn't really think about it too much. I just kept doing my philosophy. But I incorporated more elements of Christianity into my philosophy. I said, like, you know, the Trinity is like a symbol. Christ is like a symbol and stuff like that, right? And the next week, my friend who was babysitting us, he wanted to take this with us. So I was like, I'll take it with you again. And so I took 5 grams of dried shrooms again, blindfolded myself, recited this thing again a week later, which is not a good idea. But obviously not a good idea, obviously. And I took this, and it was completely inverted this time. It was just demonic. It was completely diabolic. The best way to describe it was it felt like we were doing weird rituals. So when I was, you know, tripping, I picked up this iPhone charger and I started wrapping it around my finger just for fun. I felt compelled to do it. I don't know why I was doing it. But then my friend who took it with me, he started spinning around in the same patterns. And I pulled the iPhone charger this way, and then he would like slide this way. And he was just like laughing hysterically, and we both were. And I was like, what's going on? And he's like, I don't know, it just feels so good. And it felt like we were like puppets controlled. And I was like, wow, this is like really weird. Because I don't know why I'm spinning this iPhone charger around. And I don't know why he's spinning around. And things are synchronized, and this is so weird. And it felt like we did this for hours. But the crazy thing is he doesn't even remember this. And it just felt like completely wicked, like a ritual. And then afterwards, we had this weird compulsion that we need to merge, like my philosophy. We need to become God. We need to merge together. So we like crawled up on the bed, and we like put our heads against each other, and we were like wrestling. We were like, we gotta merge. And we were like pushing up against each other. And it was kind of gay, not gonna lie. But yeah. But we were like, we gotta merge. And it felt so good. We're like, yeah, we gotta merge. But I don't know what it was really weird. And it was like, we were trying to merge for a long time. And it was like, we were not merging. And then I had a series of like weird thought patterns where I thought like, wait a second, what if he's just a projection in my mind? He has all these, you know, attributes that are like these character traits. You know, he's super smart. He has a high verbal IQ. And you know, I want to be like that, but I don't have those things. So I thought that he was just a projection of my mind. And I thought like, wait a second, what if I'm like Satan and he's like Christ? And the reason why I can't be like Christ is because he's preventing me from doing that. So I thought I had to kill him. And so I was like, I got to kill him. If you guys ever watched the movie, A Beautiful Mind, So, you know, John Nash in that movie, right? He's schizophrenic and he has this imaginary roommate. And in this one scene in the movie, they like break the window and they like chuck everything out from his room. And this was like a turning point in his life. And I was like, I gotta recreate this. But like by killing my friend, it's like, I gotta do that. And so I walk up to him and I'm like, yeah, he's like Christ. And I'm like, Satan, I need to get rid of him so I could become him. So I punch him in the face and I break his blinds and I'm about to like chuck him out the window. And then he screams at me. He said, Brian! And I was like, wait, what? And then like reality just kicked in at that point. I was like, wait, what was I trying to do? Like, that was the stupidest thing I've ever thought. Like, I'm like Satan and he's like Christ and I gotta like kill, like what? But it was so clear when I was, you know, when I was thinking about it and I was like, yeah, I gotta do this. And so he kicked me out of his room. I went back to my room and I cut off all my hair with a pair of scissors. That was what the vision was like, by the way. It's like a mixture of those two scenes, kind of. So I cut off all of my hair with a pair of scissors, and it's sort of like a cleansing ritual. I was like, yeah, I need to get to the root of this problem. I need to cut off all of my hair. I need to like free myself from all of these, you know, bad, you know, addictions, desires, and whatnot. And this actually kind of reminds me of something that G.K. Chesterton said. He said that, you know, a bunch of the ancient peoples, they all had these different like cleaning rituals, purification rituals. You know, whether or not they worked is debatable. But something that was undebated was the fact that they need to be cleansed. The problem with modern man is that he doesn't even believe in the dirt. He doesn't believe that he's filthy. He doesn't think he needs to be cleansed. But I really felt that when I was like cutting off all of my hair. I was like, yeah, I need to make penance for all this. It's like a new baptism. So I cut off all my hair with a pair of scissors and I like washed it all away. And I was like, yes, I have like repented. And then I went to bed and I woke up bald and I was like, what did I just do? I woke up bald and I punched my you know, one of my best friends in the face. And I was like, what did I just do? And I tore his blinds as well. I was like, man, what did I just do? I was like, I'm done with drugs for now. Forever. And so at that point, I vowed, I'm not going to take drugs anymore. So I kept doing a lot of philosophy and stuff like that and trying to make sense of this, all of this stuff, but it wasn't making sense. And one day, randomly, I get an ad on YouTube, and it's by this guy named Roy Schumann. So Roy Schumann is a Harvard professor who was a convert to the Catholic faith from Judaism. So he had a similar story as to me, but basically, you know, he was an atheist during his teenage years, and one day he's walking through the forest, and he just has this feeling of, like, the transcendent God welcoming him into, like, you know, communion with him. And so he started praying every single night, and then a year later, he had a dream where he met the Blessed Virgin Mary, and she recited a prayer, the O Mary Conceived Without Sin prayer on the miraculous medal in Portuguese. So he didn't know about this prayer, and he didn't know Portuguese, but he remembered this prayer phonetically, and he got one of his Portuguese Catholic friends to recite this prayer, and he found out it was this prayer. Now, the crazy thing about this prayer was given to a Catholic mystic nun, St. Catherine Laboure, and I just heard the story, and I was like, wow, this is, like, pretty crazy. Like, how do I make sense of this? And I saved this YouTube video, but I didn't really think too much about it. I was like, maybe, you know, there's a psychological way to, you know, explain this all, right? And so after this point, I felt sort of compelled to include a lot of, like, Christian elements into my philosophy. And so I started, including more Christian elements. I started looking at, like, Bible quotes, but I was obviously misinterpreting them. I kept interpreting, like, all these Bible passages in light of, like, my pantheistic views. And now it's the summer of 2020. I'm, you know, back into all of my bad habits. I'm going back playing Fortnite again. I'm going back, you know, addicted to lust again. I'm doing all these things. And it felt like all of my progress was gone. For 9 months, I was trying to live a more stoic life. I quit, you know, smoking. I quit gaming. I tried to quit lust, tried to quit all these things, but, you know, I kept falling back into them. But now I was just embracing it all. I was like, I don't care. This philosophy stuff, I cannot solve it. It's impossible to solve. I'm just going to live, you know, however I want to. But then one night I did something, probably the most regrettable sin in my life, second most regrettable sin in my life, and I'm crying out to God, and, you know, I don't even know if I believe in God at this point, but I'm crying out, I'm saying, like, you know, God, if you're there, like, help me overcome this. The next night, I'm talking, or I get a call from my friend from high school, Kevin, and he's talking to me, and he never calls me, and so I thought it was kind of weird, but he's talking about, like, some girl problems, and I was getting back into philosophy, and I was like, no, man, like, put that all aside, like, focus on philosophy, and, And so we went on a walk and we talked a little bit, and he was sort of like a fallen away Protestant, but he still had some Christian beliefs. And so he was talking about, like, Christ and the Trinity, and I was like, no, man, these are all symbols, dude. Like, it's all a symbol for, like, the process to become God and all this stuff. And he's like, yeah, okay. He said he felt compelled to give me this book. It was a book by this guy named Rick Warren. He's a Protestant pastor. It was like, why on earth are you here? Like, what's your purpose in life? And it was one of those books where it's like 40 chapters and you read like a chapter a day. And I was just gonna read the entire book in one sitting, but my friend's like, no, like, please read a chapter a day, please. And I was like, fine, I'll do it. So I started reading a chapter a day for 40 days. And as I was reading it, I was like, yeah, I actually believe a lot of this stuff. Yeah, I think, you know, my life does have meaning and purpose. I think God does love me. I think all of these things are true. And so I started looking more into this stuff. And then one day, randomly, I was on Twitter, and this guy named Owen Cyclops, he posts something about the rosary. He made, like, a hand-carved, like, rosary cutout. And I only knew him because I was in, like, far-right Twitter, and I like politics and stuff. So he was also on there. I saw this rosary thing. I was like, I've never seen what the rosary was before. Like, what is this thing, right? And then, actually, we have a picture of the post right here. Yes. So, yeah, he was, like, selling this. And I was like, that's pretty cool. And then later on that day, I was on the internet somewhere else, completely isolated section of the internet, and some other guy brought up the rosary. And I was like, wow, this is, like, the first time I'm hearing this term, but I'm hearing it, like, twice in one day. It's like a synchronicity. It's like, I should, like, look this up. So I looked it up. And I went to r/Catholicism, and I found all these, like, stories about, like, the rosary. And all these people were talking about, like, oh, like, I met the Blessed Virgin Mary. Oh, like, I felt at peace. Oh, like, I converted because of this. Oh, like, Our Lady's, like, so awesome and stuff. And I was like, yeah, whatever. But I was like, wow, there's, like, a lot of testimonies. It's sort of like what I heard about, like, Mother Ayahuasca and about, like, the mushroom. Like, I got to try this out. So I looked up how to pray the rosary for dummies. .com or whatever, or on how to pray the rosary, or how, you know what I'm trying to say. Anyways, I look it up, and I'm reciting the rosary, but I'm not even doing it well. I'm doing this every night, and I feel at peace, like, yeah, this is good. I like this. And I started looking more into, like, you know, Catholicism, found some Bishop Barron videos, stuff like that. And I was like, yeah, some of this stuff is good. And I started praying the rosary, and then one day I watched a video from Bishop Barron. He's talking about, like, hell and stuff, and I was like, I don't want to go to hell. I don't want my mom to go to hell. So I started praying for my mom. So it was like 9:30 p.m., and I'm praying for my mom, you know, telling, asking God, like, you know, please save my mom, free her from, you know, sin and stuff, and help her. And then I'm heading to bed, and as I head to bed, I'm watching this video on YouTube. This guy named Gabby After Hours, he's talking about, like, pray 4 rosaries a day. I'm like, yeah, no. And so I text from my mom that says, come downstairs. I'm like, why is my mom telling me to come downstairs? Like, I'm in the same house as her. She never texts me when I'm in the same house. So I come downstairs, and she's puking all over the place. She's having the worst migraine of her life. And I'm like, wait a second, I just prayed for her, like, an hour ago. Like, is this connected? And so I help her out. I'm, you know, giving her medicine. I'm cleaning up for her. And, you know, I tuck her in, and I'm thinking, like, she's dead. Like, she's gone. Like, I'm thinking, like, this is our last day. So I was crying in the other room, and I heard a voice say, like, you know, pray 4 rosaries for her. I was like, all right, fine. So I prayed 3 more rosaries for her, and then I consecrated her to Jesus through Mary, and then I fell asleep, and I cried myself to sleep, actually. And then I woke up, and she was totally fine, completely fine. I was like, wow, like, that's awesome. And then I asked her, like, what was that all about? She said, it might have been, like, the papaya I ate, or, yeah. Yeah, she said that, or it might have been God. She said, like, or it might have been God. I was like, wait, why'd you say that? You never bring up God. And I started bawling at that point. I was like, that was a moment of, like, divine confirmation. Like, that was from God, because she never brings up God. I was like, what was that all about? And then I told her, like, I'm going to become Christian. And she's like, no, like, don't become Christian. And I was like, but she doesn't know, like, any of the stuff that's happening, like, in this journey. And I'm like, no, I'm becoming Christian, Mom. And then the next night, you know, or the next day, I'm, like, watching more Catholic videos. I see this video about, like, exorcisms and stuff like that, and, like, I don't know if I believe in demons and stuff, but the Catholic Church says, you know, there's demons and stuff, so, you know, let me pray about it. So I was praying the rosary, and then I was asking, you know, if demons are real, God, please let me know. And so that night, I was going to bed, and I had a dream, a sleep paralysis dream, for the first time in 6 months, since the last one. And this time, I'm, like, in my room, laying in my bed, and I feel this bad thing pinning me down, the same bad thing that was pinning me down in the previous dreams, like, 6 months ago. It just feels wicked, awful. I know this thing is evil. And so I was like, what do I do? Well, I got to recite a prayer. I know 3 prayers. I know the Hail Mary, the Our Father, and the Glory Be. So let me do that, because that's what the exorcist did. So I was starting to recite a prayer. I was like, Our Father. And then this thing started talking. It said, like, in hell, right? It was, like, blaspheming, saying bad things, and trying to prevent me from praying. I was, like, freaking out. I was like, what just happened? Like, this thing is speaking. Like, this is a demon. And so I was like, I couldn't finish that prayer. So I was like, let me move on to the next one. Let me move on to the Hail Mary instead. So I said, like, Hail Mary full. And this thing said, like, oh shit, right? And then I hear another voice saying, like, kiss me in a very gay voice, like Judas or something like that. But all these voices were attacking me. But they're all coming from one source, and they're trying to prevent me from praying. And I had one prayer left, so I was like, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end, amen. Right as it said amen, the voice shrieked, I woke up, and lightning struck at the same time. And I was like, I believe in God. yeah. And so I was, you know, just rocked out of my mind then. And then I was counting, like, how many times did lightning strike afterwards? It was like 5 lightning strikes in, like, the next 10 minutes. I was like, yeah, that was not just a coincidence. That was, like, divine providence right there. And I was freaking out, and I was like, yeah, I believe in God. But I was like, yeah, I believe in God. This is a good thing. I believe in God now. I started praying the rosary every day, and it felt like Our Lady was, like, reorienting my mind. She was showing me all the sins of my past, all these repressed memories, things even from, like, middle school that I didn't remember, just, like, started popping up. I had, like, flashbacks, like, every night for, like, 2 months. I was, like, just crying every night and, like, repenting, like, you know, apologizing to Christ for all the times I've sinned against him, turned against him. And it just felt like, you know, my entire life was just me being a follower of Satan. And I realized that, you know, that voice telling me that 9 months ago was right. I was a follower of Satan. I was spreading, you know, the counter gospel. I was leading people away from the faith. I was leading people to do drugs, to do lustful things, to do evil things, and I was getting all my friends to do it. I was, like, one of the best evangelists for, like, Satan at that time, and I was just living a terrible, terrible life, and I didn't realize that until I tried to live for Christ. But Our Lady helped me throughout this entire process. I was praying the rosary, and I was getting really into, like, philosophy, theology, and all of that stuff, and I was seeing the writings of like St. Thomas Aquinas, and I realized that he was addressing the same questions that I had, but his answers made sense. It wasn't like all mental gymnastics, like, oh, we're gonna become God. No, God is unlimited, unbounded. That's why he always is. And we can't become God because you can't cause something to become uncaused. And so I realized, yeah, like these things all make sense. And not only is like my intellect pointing to the Catholic Church, but my experience as well, and like all my emotions. And I realized, like, yeah, like this is all true. And I kept praying the rosary. And within 2 weeks, I like got like pretty deep into like apologetics. I was like already writing defenses for like Our Lady, like why the intercession of the Blessed Virgin is good against Protestants and stuff like that. And so I was becoming a strong defender of Our Lady early on. And I was just like really into all of this stuff. And then I heard about like, you know, RCIA, and I was like, I emailed Father David about RCIA. And I actually said, here, we could read it. So this was like a week or two after I started praying the rosary. And I said, Dear Father David, I would like to jump into RCIA to become Catholic. I was an atheist my entire life. However, through months of pondering metaphysical questions, I was pointed towards God. After looking at the evidence for Christianity, I came to believe it is the one true religion through historical accounts of the resurrection. I want to be Catholic rather than Protestant or Eastern Orthodox because I believe in the Holy Catholic Church, or I believe that the Holy Catholic Church is the one true church established by Jesus. I'm a beginner when it comes to aspects of the faith, but I've prepared myself by getting hold of the essential doctrines. Although I just started reading them, I have the Catechism, the Summa Theologica, the Holy Bible, and have been praying the rosary every day. I strongly believe that praying the rosary has guided me closer to the faith and has solidified all my beliefs. It would mean a lot if I could become Catholic, yada, yada, yada. And then he sends me an email back talking about like RCIA begins like now. And so when I entered into RCIA, everyone thought like I was like, you know, basically, you know, a very well-formed Christian for a while because, you know, I've been like just grinding this stuff out for like a month right now. Like, that's all I did. Like, that's literally all I did. I spent all my waking hours just doing like apologetics and like theology and philosophy and like trying to learn this stuff. And everyone came in thinking like, you know, like, oh, who is this guy? Like, he seems like a devout Catholic. But at that point, like, no one knew about like any of the stuff that was going on, but my life was already radically changing after like a couple weeks of praying the rosary. Even my family noticed, my friends noticed. And when I came back to school, I like dedicated my life to Christ. I started going to daily mass, started going to Eucharistic adoration, started to like sneak into the chapel late night and just pray. And I was just forming a very intimate relationship with Christ. And it felt like, yes, like this is what I've been longing for all this time. It's like what St. Augustine says, like, you know, the heart is restless until it rests in God. And I realized I was trying to find like this infinite source of good through like all these different things, through lust, through weed, through video games. But all these things, you know, they never filled my cravings. They only like temporarily satiated my passions, but they made me always want to desire more. After I, you know, committed any sins, I just wanted more. I wanted more. But none of these things ever fulfilled me. But when I found, you know, the Eucharist, I realized like, yeah, this is like what I'm, you know, meant for. And so I started you know, just living this liturgical lifestyle, going to daily mass, changing my life, repenting of all my sins, trying to learn more about theology, philosophy, trying to do good works, trying to get people to pray the rosary, giving people miraculous medals. I don't know if any of you guys were there when I was in RCIA, but I used to hand out miraculous medals a lot to a lot of you guys. I bought like 200, 300, 400 of these. I used to like sneak them around at night, like at the edge apartments, like when no one's looking at night, I'd like sneak them around, like here you go, by the doors, like, I coincidentally put it there and stuff like that. But yeah, I was just living for our Lord Jesus and Our Lady. And then last Easter, I got baptized, confirmed in First Communion all in once, yeah. Thank you guys so much. And since then, I've just been trying to, you know, live for our Lord. It's been tough, but it's always worth it, and it's always great. And I know that, you know, praying the rosary is something that is just so important to me. And I know that, you know, if you guys try to pray the rosary, if you fail, but you just keep trying, you know, this thing will lead you to Christ. Because if I didn't pray the rosary, I don't know where I'd be. Honestly, I'd probably be like on the side of the street, like snorting crack or something like that, honestly. Yeah. You know, so the rosary is so good, and Our Lady is so good, and she helps you every step of the way. And so, yeah, that is a brief rundown of my conversion story. Thank you, guys. Pray the rosary, and any questions?